is found on John 5:22-27. He says, "Moreover, the Father judged. No one but has entrusted all judgment to the Son, that all might honor the Son, just as they honor the Father. Whoever does not honor the Son does not honor the Father who sent him. Very truthful, very truly, I will tell you, whoever hears my word and believes him who sent me has eternal life and will not be judged, but has crossed over from death to life. Very truly, I'll tell you, a time is coming, it has not come, when the dead will hear the voice of the Son of God, and those who will hear will live. For as the Father has life in himself, so he has granted the Son also to have life in himself. And he has given him authority to judge, because he is the Son of Man." You might be seated. Thank you.
Oh God, how I need. hear me? All right, good. And if I trail off towards the end, seem a little tired, you just wave at me so I know to speak up. In the late 70s, I was entering the workforce in my career, having finished my first degree in college. And when I was doing that, I was not an Adventist. I was not raised an Adventist like some of you. And it was a lot of study for me. It was a struggle. I was raised Lutheran, and I had done a lot of things. But I had to study this thing, this Adventism. We had run across it because I had, my first job was in southwestern Michigan, and there were some Adventists around. And I studied then. I kept studying. I moved to Kentucky. I was running a piece of a business down there already. And what is this Adventist thing? I got a book out, and I started every doctrine writing down what I learned about it. It was a struggle. And finally, I was baptized in 1984. Sounds like a long time, probably before some of you were born. Yeah, I have some gray hairs. And about, I don't know whether it was 3 or 6 months later, I got a letter in the mail from the pastor who baptized me, a young pastor. He sent it to every member of his church, inclusive of me, saying he was leaving the church, didn't believe it anymore. No. For me, I had to go back to that book and restudy. And to lose him, I knew him well, a friend, was difficult. More lately, I've come across another, even closer friend who's concerned about what others are saying about our church, what others believe, what we believe. He's challenged. And so I came up for the third time approaching what I'm going to do. Approaching first this particular sermon because it's important, and I'll explain why in a minute, but also a series on what it is we believe and why we believe it and why sola scriptura is important to it. I believe we're going to be challenged as a church like we've never been before, and as individuals like we've never been before. That roaring lion has decided it's time. And so my scriptures that I'm going to share with you are from the heart. And it's to clarify some things. Now, what we're going to study today is not easy to study. It's about the heavenly sanctuary and what it means to us. What I've attempted to do is to make it simple, straightforward, clear, and biblical. So I hope you find that in what you hear today, and I hope you find it inspiring, because truly, of all the doctrines we have, this is one that's most inspiring. Not the most, but it is right up there at the top. I'll also say, and then I'll begin the sermon, that there's two of our fundamental beliefs that are uncommon to most of the rest of Christianity, and this is one of them. That's why I started here. If you take the Sabbath, even the Sabbath, there are many Sabbath churches. There are many Sabbath believers. There are Sabbath keepers from many different areas. This one, however, is even more unique than the Sabbath. And because of that, it's attacked first. When Satan wants to pull someone away from our church, related to doctrine, this is one that he tries to attack. So I'm going to try to lay a foundation, like rails, nailed to the ground, of why this is truth from Scripture. So, as Seventh-day Adventists, we are Christians. We follow Christ and his teachings. Don't let anyone draw you away from that truth. We are Christians. We love other Christians. We believe other Christians will be with us in heaven. And we love our Lord, Jesus Christ. As Seventh-day Adventists, we believe in the foundational statement of sola scriptura, which I'm going to talk to in a minute. And as SDAs, we have a set of shared beliefs. There is a movement today that's trying to separate us. In the time that my pastor left, it was led by a man named Desmond Ford, a man who had left Adventism and wanted to just tear it apart. They try to confuse us related to these shared beliefs. In fact, I believe there are two components to this movement that work in concert, and I want you to name it, because if you know the wolf is out there and how he paces, you know how to protect yourself. One is that is external. This one seeks to deny us these truths and keep us them from others. So there's external groups who want to keep this truth from others. And then there is one internal, which makes them, and that's the one that tries to make the truths we believe too complex and not as Christ-centered as God intended them to be. So we have to watch out for both. Let's not make God's truth complex. He didn't mean it to be complex, right? And so I'm going to try to put together in this discussion something that helps with both of these issues related to the heavenly sanctuary. I want to share this as a series with you. I want this to be the beginning of that series, and I want you to spend time listening to me. In fact, I'm likely going to overwhelm you a bit with scriptures today, because I want this, everything you believe, to be based on these scriptures and the fact that these scriptures do present this story, this truth. And as I said, this is the first time I've attempted. This is the third time I tried to put this together, and I resisted. But it is important. So here it is. I mean, it's a lot of, whoops, I'm not pushing the button here right. I got to keep going here. I'm going to have to get with it. Wow, can you read this? This is our fundamental belief number 23. This one says that there is a sanctuary in heaven, the true tabernacle which the Lord set up, and not man. In it, Christ ministers on our behalf, making available to believers the benefits of his atoning sacrifice, offered once for all on the cross. He was inaugurated as our great high priest and began his intercessory ministry at the time of ascension. In 1844, at the end of the prophetic period of 2300 days, he entered the second and last phase of his atoning ministry in heaven. It is a work of investigative judgment, which is part of the ultimate disposition of all sin, the removal of all sin. Typified by the cleansing of the ancient Hebrew sanctuary on the Day of Atonement. In that typical service, the sanctuary was cleansed with the blood of animal sacrifices, but the heavenly things are purified with the perfect sacrifice of the blood of Jesus. The investigative judgment reveals to heavenly intelligences who among the dead are asleep in Christ and therefore in him are deemed worthy to have part in the first resurrection. It also makes manifest who among the living are abiding in Christ, keeping the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus, and in him, therefore, are ready for translation into his everlasting kingdom. This judgment vindicates the justice of God in saving those who believe in Jesus. It declares that those who have remained loyal to God shall receive the kingdom. The completion of this ministry of Christ will mark the close of human probation before the second advent. A lot of words there, but I wanted to read it. Some of us haven't heard it since we were baptized. Essentially, this doctrine, this belief that is unique, is one that we need to explore. And we need to explore the challenges that others bring against it. But before we do that, I want to talk about sola scriptura. just to make sure we all understand what that means. The dictionary would say sola scriptura is the Christian doctrine that the Bible is the supreme authority in all matters of doctrine and practice. Sola scriptura is the Christian doctrine that the Bible is the supreme authority in all matters of doctrine and practice. We as Adventists believe that. We read other books. We read other writings. We have other people we like to read. But when it comes down to what is truth, the Bible, the scripture, the holy canon is what we turn to. And that's what we're going to do today. I could quote others. And I do have one small section of explanation I will share with you from one other. But everything else in this sermon is scripture. Now, these are beliefs that I read. When I read that number 23 of our beliefs, I got to keep doing this, man. Sorry. This is what I read to you. I'm going the wrong way, that's why. Here. So in the 23rd belief that I shared with you, these are the things that people will challenge. First of all, that there is a sanctuary in heaven. Secondly, that Christ ministers in that sanctuary. That his work is a work of judgment in that sanctuary. That Christ is the judge who is to judge who are his true followers, who are saved, both the dead and the living. And that this judgment vindicates, this is a direct quote from what we read, the judgment vindicates the justice of God in saving those who believe in Jesus. It declares that those who have remained loyal to God shall receive the kingdom. And that the completion of this ministry of Christ will mark the close of human probation before the second advent. Meaning, when he finishes, he comes. He comes back. His second coming happens. Those who are dead rise. And those who believe in him, have trusted him, have stayed with him on the earth, will rise with the dead, and we'll all go to heaven. Beautiful. Amen, right? We're going to go to heaven. And this is just what is happening before that, just before that. So now let's turn to some scriptures and talk through the first couple of these. Is there a sanctuary in heaven? Does Christ minister in that sanctuary? So I'm going to share some verses with you, and I'm going to go through a number of them. You can turn to those you have time. The first one is Hebrews 8, 1 and 2. Read it with me. Now, this is the main point of the things which we are saying. We have such a high priest who is seated on the right hand of the throne of the majesty in heavens, a minister of the sanctuary and of the true tabernacle, which the Lord erected, not man. Now, before I go on and read another one of Paul's writings, and I want to state this. There really has always been, since the Hebrews left Egypt, two sanctuaries. One on earth and one in heaven. Prior to that, there was only the one in heaven. And there still is today two sanctuaries. When Christ died, we know the veil was ripped. And the sanctuary in this earth that the Hebrews had was null and void. There's no more sacrifice of lambs. But the true tabernacle and sanctuary of Christ is you and I. It says in Scripture that we are priests and tabernacles. Are you God's sanctuary here on earth? While he also has a sanctuary in heaven. Paul also wrote in Hebrews 9:1, then indeed even the first covenant had ordinances of divine service and the early sanctuary. And then in 23 through 24, it was therefore necessary that the patterns of things in the heavens should be purified with these, but the heavenly things themselves with better sacrifice than these. For Christ has not entered into the holy places made with hands, which are the figures of the true, but into heaven itself, now to appear in the presence of God for us. Now, I've put a lot of other scriptures at the bottom here. There are lots of scriptures talking about the heavenly sanctuary. These two I've chosen specifically to show that that it's clear that the present heavenly sanctuary is a real place. It has real purpose. It is not a metaphor abstraction. It's a real place. The heavenly sanctuary is the primary dwelling of God. And as it says, Christ appears before God in that heavenly sanctuary. This is really important for us to understand. Right now, Christ and God the Father are in that heavenly sanctuary. And their purpose in that sanctuary is to discuss you and I, to help you and I, to minister for you and I. So, we talk about what's happening in the sanctuary. Is Christ's work in the sanctuary a work of judgment? Some who even would agree with us that there is a sanctuary say there is no judgment. They would say to you that when Christ died on the cross and you accept Christ, there's no more. You're Christian forever. That's a falsehood. Christ's death on the cross is what saves us. But he does judge whether we truly accepted it and whether we held on to it, whether we made it at the center of our lives. So let's look at some of the scriptures here. Let's take 2 Corinthians 5:10. I'm not going to read all four of them. All of you can read. I'm going to read a couple. 2 Corinthians 5:10. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that everyone may receive the things done in his body, according to what he's done, whether it be good or bad. To me, good, bad, these are nice words. This is a simple scripture. That we will be judged. Now, let's explore this in our minds a minute. Christ died on the cross. We accept him. And through his acceptance, that acceptance, we receive full salvation. Don't take me wrong. There's nothing held back. We are saved. We are also asked by Christ, and he asked his followers this many times, to take action. In fact, let's take Peter as an example. Peter, he said, "Do you love me?" And what did Peter say? "Yes, Lord." And Christ said, "Feed my sheep," right? How many times did he do that? Three times. He wanted to embed this idea that you love me. Okay, we have this relationship. You are saved through my grace. And you have to take action. Feed my sheep. Show me that you love me. Don't just say it. Right? It hasn't changed since Christ's time. Let's take another one. I'm going to go to Acts 17:30-31. And the times of this ignorance God winked at, but now commands all men everywhere to repent, because he has appointed a day, can also be translated time, in the which he will judge the world in righteousness by that man whom he has ordained. He has given assurance of all this to all men by raising him from the dead. Christ is in the heavenly sanctuary and he judges. I could give you 10 other verses. Here's four really strong ones. These show that Christ went into the heavenly sanctuary to judge. Now, what is he judging? Is he judging whether you're worthy of salvation? No. Is he judging whether he really gave you salvation when you asked for it with a true heart? No. He's judging whether you held on to that salvation and did something with it, like the 10 talents. The talents. Did he bury it? Yes, and give back one. Did you lose it along the way? Why is he doing this judgment? It's not because he and God don't already know. It's pretty clear from Scripture. They know every step you take. They know every hair on your head. But they want to make sure the worlds that are watching this great controversy between Satan and God, they want every world to know that this judgment is true, factual, that this judgment is correct. Because I tell you, there's only two things that can happen to man after he comes to this earth. He either goes to heaven or he's destroyed. You and I, that's our two choices. And I have to tell you, too, that it's based on whether we really have faith or not. By faith you are saved. But not by faith once I said, I have faith, forgive me. It's a faith that is embedded. It's a faith that's changing, a faith that's dwelling in us, a faith that changes us. It's a faith, a gift of God, a belief that becomes part of us. That's what saves mankind. Did you know that Hitler professed to be a Christian at one point? He also decided to kill thousands of Jews. I don't know. But I will say this, there are many who can profess at one point and lose their faith. Not embedded in their life. There is a judgment. Let's read a couple other more on this judgment because this is one thing that's challenged. Let's take, I'm going to go to Thessalonians here. Which is a manifest token of the righteous judgment of God, that ye may be counted worthy of the kingdom of God. You see the word righteous judgment? This is the core of why this exercise occurs of his studying the life of men. For the time has come that judgment must begin at the house of God, and if it first begin at us, what shall the end of them that obey not the gospel of God? And if the righteous scarcely be saved, where shall the ungodly and the sinner appear? This is pretty strong language. But it does start at the house of God, the dead, and then the living, and then all the others who never professed to follow him. I will say, and I'm going to pick this as part of this too, there are some who say that in the end of time, if you're not Adventist, you won't be saved. If you're not a Sabbath keeper, you won't be saved. That's not what the scripture reads. Right? I believe, and this is personal belief, so put it in the Jeff Taube corner, not the Church of Seventh-day Adventists. I believe that even at the end of time, there will be those who are living that Christ takes up that are non-Adventists, that are non-Sabbath keepers. Okay? So let's not use any of this to be discriminatory. Okay? I want to be clear. But it is true that men will be judged by what they do with what Christ has given them. They've given him a new life. They've given him salvation, an opportunity to live forever. What are you going to do with that? And he will judge what you do, whether you did something with that, whether you really, really, really loved him in return for what he's given you. Now, another thing that's challenged is whether there's judgment books, which we believe, which is in that number 23. Here's some verses on the fact that there's books. I'm going to read the one from Malachi. Then they that feared the Lord spake often one to another, and the Lord hearkened and heard it. And a book of remembrance was written before him for them that feared the Lord, and that thought upon his name. See that? That feared the Lord and thought upon his name. That's action. And they shall be mine, saith the Lord of hosts, in that day when I make up my jewels, and I will spare them, as a man spares his own son that serves him. His own son that serves him. You read these words? It is wonderful, beautiful, unbelievable in some ways that Christ will offer us salvation free and clear. That he died on the cross for you specifically, and that you can be saved. It is probably the most beautiful thing of act of love that anyone can say. It says in the Bible what's more than what a man would give his life for another man, right? But it will die. Just like the seed that's thrown on the rocks and gets seared by the sun, it will die unless you do something with it. And when it dies, you will die with it. Scripture guarantees that judgment will come. And I'm not trying to be doom and gloom about this. I'm trying to lift up Christ and what he's given us and how important it is and how you should hold on to it and nurture it and make it part of you, inculcate it into your life. That's how important it is, not just for your salvation, but that you might live here a life more abundantly. Judgment is an important concept. There is a judgment of the wicked. Again, I'm only going to read one of these verses. Anyone who wants this after can spend more time with it too. And in fact, I'll do two. I'm going to read Psalms and then Peter, one right after the other. Have mercy upon me, O God, according to thy loving kindness, according unto the multitude of thy tender mercies, blot out my transgressions. Wash me thoroughly from mine iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. For I acknowledge my transgression and my sin is ever before me. Against thee, thee only, have I sinned and done this evil in thy sight, that thou mightest be justified when thou speakest and be clear when thou judgest. I am a sinner. David says, I am a sinner. It's before me day and night. And when you judge, it's there. But then he says, hide my face from my sins and blot out all my iniquities. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit in me. Create in me a clean heart. Wash away this sin. Pull it apart and throw it out of my life. And then renew a right spirit within me. Help me never to repeat it. Beautiful language from David, right from the heart of a man who did great sins like you and I. But he had said above that there's a judgment. And be clear when thou judgest. David, beloved of God, said, when you judge, let's be clear, because I don't want to be lost. Change me, cleanse me, and then judge me. That's David's words. Here we have, again, Peter in Acts 3:19. Repent ye therefore and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out. The Bible says your sins are thrown once you truly ask for forgiveness into the deep blue sleep. You and I, Arnie here, if he upsets me, I'm going to remember that a long time. In my human spirit, I would, right? God says, you sin against me, you truly ask forgiveness. I throw it in deep blue sleep, it doesn't exist. You talk to me about it, I say, I don't know what you're talking about. I don't know what you're talking about, because it's gone. Now, you can repeat that sin, and it's not gone anymore, okay? But my point here is, it's meant to be washed totally away. When the times of refreshing shall come from the presence of the Lord, the times of refreshing will come. There will be a time after the judgment when only those who God has able to work with on the sin issue are in heaven. There's no one else exists. They're all destroyed. There's a time when there's no more sin, no more pain, no more suffering, no more death, no more sickness, no more broken arms, no more broken spirits. It's gone. Can you believe that? And in that time, those of us who Christ takes into heaven will sin no more. We'll eschew, to use an old word, sin. And it isn't done with a magic wand. It's done because we love Christ and what he's given us so much. That's how it's done, through love. Christ's love and his intent are revealed in this belief we have. Christ, the depth of Christ's love is revealed in this sanctuary message. Some see it as just a judgment. How can that be love? It's all about love. Daniel 7, 18 and 22. Until the ancient of days came and a judgment was made in favor of the saints of the Most High, and the time came for the sins to possess the kingdom, the saints to possess the kingdom. This judgment is tied with us possessing the kingdom inexorably by the fact that we are judged. We have a right to possess the kingdom that he gives us. Matthew, whosoever there shall confess me before men, him will I confess also before my Father which is in heaven. But whosoever shall deny me before men, him will I also deny before my Father which is in heaven. Pretty clear statement. Does that sound a little bit about a subject we have in this church, one that's important to us called evangelism, by the way? Is there something in there? Do you confess God before your coworkers, your neighbors? Or do you be quiet? Or do you even, at times, by your actions, deny him? It's a challenge to think about. Luke 12, 8 and 9. Also I say unto you, whosoever shall confess me before men, him shall the Son of Man confess before the angels of God. But he that denieth me before men shall be denied before the angels of God. Why is this one here? Why is that different? The first one, which is he will confess him before the Father in heaven, that he will support us, that he will say, this is one of my sheep before the Father. And then we have this angels of God. Other created beings. This has to do with what I mentioned before. This judgment process isn't only about you and I and God, the Father, and Jesus. It's about all of the world's understanding what sin is and understanding the love of God towards everyone in the universe. How far he will go in that love. That he will desire his own Son as the Father and that the Son will give his own life. That's how far he will go. That's how far he will go that we might be saved and that love would permeate all universes. That the foundation would be love and caring, not sin and destruction, as Satan brought to us. Okay. I'm going to read one more, Revelation 22:11, and then we'll move on. Again, I'm taking postulates that some say are against what we believe and trying to show you where in Scripture it says exactly what we believe. The time is at hand. He that is unjust, let him be unjust still. And he which is filthy, let him be filthy still. And he that is righteous, let him be righteous still. And he that is holy, let him be holy still. And behold, I come quickly, and my reward is with me to give to every man according to the work to as his work shall be. I am the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. Blessed are they that do his commandments, that they may have the right to the tree of life and may enter through the gates into the city. I'm sorry, but I don't read in Scripture that a man can accept Christ and go on sinning and be in heaven. I am sorry, but I do not read in Scripture that a man can accept Christ and in the coldness of his heart treat other men badly. Christ himself summarized the Ten Commandments into two commandments. Love your God with all your heart and with all your mind, and love your fellow man as yourself. I'm sorry. That's what's going to be in heaven. If you're not ready for that, you're not going to be there. Judgment will truly show whether you accepted Christ and whether you held on to that belief. Part of what is challenged, actually, when you challenge this idea of a sanctuary and God as a judge in heaven is actually whether Christ is really our Redeemer. And I'm gonna read this. Although we live in the awesome time of the antitypical Day of Atonement, okay, that's just basically the time when Christ's blood is in the heavenly sanctuary used to atone for our sins, okay? That's all it's talking about. We have no need to fear, Jesus, fear. We really don't have any need to fear. Jesus Christ, in his twofold capacity of sacrifice and priest, ministers in the heavenly sanctuary in our behalf. Excuse me. Now you know why I brought the cup. As Paul said, we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God. Let us hold fast, hold on tight to our confession. For we do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weakness. Excuse me one more time. But was in all points tempted as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. Christ, God the Father, and Christ are probably more loving than we can even appreciate. He's more delicate and careful about us than we can appreciate. I don't know about you, but I can speak for me. I have sinned, and I have repeated the same sins. I confess it before you. I have to say also that when I think about God the Father living with my mess and fixing it, I see real mercy. Right? I see someone so loving that he puts up with my filth. So loving that he will continue to pursue me, to change me, to make me more worthy, more worthwhile, better than I am. To make me a better husband, father, to make me a better person. He loves me that much. If you're a husband and your wife does wrong, or your wife and your husband does wrong, and you ignore it and don't help them, are you being loving? And helping doesn't mean chewing them out all the time, right? That's not what I'm talking about. I mean really helping them, consoling them, trusting them that they can change. That's the way God is. He trusts that we can do this. That through him, we can step away from sin. Because frankly, if we can't, we don't belong in heaven. Because we'll be back at it. And he doesn't want sin anymore. He's going to destroy people once and for all and not repeat that. So it's important that we see Christ as our Redeemer. A redeemer isn't someone who just goes and says, okay, I'm going to take you from slavery, make you a non-slave, then you're on your own. A redeemer is someone who redeems you and takes you down a new path. Right? He's our mentor in this sinful world. He's our mentor to walk away from it. The completion of this ministry of Christ will mark the close of human probation. That's another thing that's challenged. Oh, so he's in heaven, you Adventists say, and he does this judgment process, and then judgment closes, he comes back. Where do you see that in Scripture? You know, they'll challenge that. Well, I want to give you the tools and the understanding. It says in Daniel 2:1, and at the same time shall Michael stand up, and the great prince which standeth for the children of thy people. And there shall be a time of trouble such as never was since there was a nation even to that same time. And at that time thy people shall be delivered, every one that shall be found written in the book. Now if you study about this book and we don't have time, you'll find out that book is read, judgment is done, closes the book and he comes. Just like it says here in Daniel. So, I go back. Oh, shoot. I'm terrible at this. glad somebody's helping me. Here we have the things that are challenged. And I just gave you scriptures related to these challenges that outsiders will take. But we have to go deeper than that. Because just to be able to refute some that might challenge what we believe and not really get at the heart, the belly of what this is about, we're missing something. Because the true blessing in the sanctuary message has nothing to do with whether it's true or not in the scripture. It has to do with what it means to us. It has to do with what it means to us in our lives with Christ. It has to do with how we entwine our hand in His as we walk down the road. In the sanctuary services, the sacrifice of the animals occurred in the courtyard. It was these sacrifices that pointed forward to the cross of Christ. The Day of Atonement focused on the most holy place. So, what I want to get across here first is there was two things that occurred. Every day, there were sacrifices done outside of the most holy place, sacrifices done and then taken into the holy. Not the holy of holies, but into the holy. And those sacrifices were atoning for individual sins. Every day, you and I need to get out of our bed, pray to our God that we would be saved. Every day, if we do something wrong, we need to think about God in that and ask Him to forgive us. A daily sacrifice. Then, at the end, there was this Day of Atonement that foreshadowed the fact that God was going to judge and take the sins of the world away and dispose of them. There's a lot more detail, right? But that's what this is about. Now, there's a guy called A.T. Jones. You've heard of an 1888 message, right? Some of what I'm going to quote here, and he's the only one I'm using a little bit from, is from him. Because he makes it so clear I couldn't do better, I'm using it, right? He describes this process in the meaning of the day. It says, the course of the service of the sanctuary was completed annually, as I stated, and the day of the completion of the service, the 10th day of the 7th month, was especially the Day of Atonement, or the cleansing of the sanctuary. On that day, the service was concluded in the most holy place. That day was the once every year when the high priest alone went into the holiest of holies. Oh, I'm not doing this. Sorry. Sorry. I'm going to hold this in my hand so I remember. That day was the once every year when the high priest alone went into the holiest of all, the most holy place. And of the high priest in his service that day it is written, he shall make an atonement for the holy sanctuary, and he shall make an atonement for the tabernacle of the congregation and for the altar, and he shall make an atonement for the priests and for all the people of the congregation. An atonement. Let's think about what that means. He's making atonement for all the things that have to do with the church that were named. He is making an atonement for all the people of the congregation. Thus, the service of the sanctuary in the offering of the sacrifices, the ministering of the priests and the high priest alone, was for the making of atonement and for the forgiveness and sending away of the sins of the people. Because of the sin and guilt, because of their having done somewhat against any of the commandments of the Lord concerning things which should not be done, atonement must be made and forgiveness obtained. Atonement is literally an at-one-ment. The sin and the guilt had separated them from God. Your sin, my sin, our guilt separates us from God. What we do that's evil separates us from God. Nothing more scriptural than that. The atonement, the atonement, of Christ's sacrifice is what brings us back together. And it's by these services, by this going into the Most Holy, looking at the sins, looking at the life, and seeing this one has accepted me as Christ, those sins don't exist. That's what this sanctuary service is about. It was about that for the Jews back then. It's about that in the heavenly sanctuary today. It's about making us one with God. Forgive is literally give for, backwards. To forgive sin is to give for sin. Forgiveness of sin comes alone from God. He's the only one who can forgive sin. What does God give? What has he given for sin? He gave Christ. And Christ gave himself for our sins. Galatians, Ephesians, Romans. Ultimately, the acts that are done in the Holy of Holies in heaven, where he takes those who truly believe him and forgives them, is an act of his looking to his sacrifice and the blood he shed and looking God the Father in the eye and saying, this is one of my sheep. This one truly hears my voice and follows me. This one I died for, I gave my life for, he belongs in heaven, or she belongs in heaven. I'm trying to keep it simple. That's what this is about. This is the most beautiful thing you can see. Can you see Christ there saying, Arnie, Elsa has agreed, has heard my voice. They followed me. They've worked for me. They believe in me. And I died for them, God. Is there not anything more beautiful than that? Nothing. That's what you and I want him to say. Do we not? Amen. We want him to see us as his people. Individually and corporately, we want him to say, these are my people. And it happens. In reality, it happens in sanctuary. Isn't it some agreement, some unsaid words? It's said words. It's a book of life. It's an activity that really happens for you and I. Therefore, when an individual or the whole congregation of Israel had sinned and desired forgiveness, the whole problem and plan of forgiveness, of atonement, of salvation, was worked out before their faces. It wasn't hidden away somewhere. It was before their faces. The sacrifice which was brought was in faith of the sacrifice which God had already made in giving his son for sin. God had preordained he was going to give his son. Back in the time of the Hebrews, this sacrificial system was set up to point towards that. In our time, Christ is actually doing it. Now, he's looking at the book of life. In this faith, sinners were accepted of God, and Christ was received of them for their sin. Thus, they were made at one with God, and thus God would dwell in the midst of them. That is, he would dwell in each heart, this is important, and abide in each life to make the heart and life holy, harmless, undefiled, separate from sin. This goes bigger. This doesn't stop at his saying, this is my sheep, and then going on to the next one. He might be Arnie, then someone else in the congregation, someone else. It's happening. But he's also empowering us with that blood. He's also, when he says, this is my sheep, he's giving us the ability to be more like him. If we're his sheep, he expects us to follow him. And he gives us that power. And he says, right straight in the eye of God the Father, the Almighty, this is my sheep, and he follows me. And then he gives us power to do so. Righteousness by faith. Undeniable. Romans 5:1. Therefore, having been justified by faith, we have peace with God, the at-one-ment with God, through our Lord Jesus Christ. Habakkuk 2:4. Behold, as for the proud one, his soul is not right with him, but the righteous will live by faith. It doesn't say the righteous have faith. They will do what? Say it for me. They will live by faith. Do you live by faith? Are your actions based on the faith you have in Jesus Christ? Romans 1:17. For in the righteousness of God is revealed faith to faith, as it is written, but the righteous man shall live by faith. Christ doesn't just call us to say, please tell me, Jeff Taube, that you believe in me and then you'll be saved. He says that. Believe me and you'll be saved. But he also says, go and feed my sheep. He tells us to live by that faith, to make that faith part of us, not just a one-time event, but to inculcate it, a word I used earlier, to make it part of us, to put it into the grain of our life. And the placing of the tabernacle in the midst of the camp was an illustration, an object lesson and suggestion of the truth that he shall dwell in the midst of each individual. Do you think they killed those sheep, goats, doves every day only that the one they killed for you yesterday was the only one that counted? It was there every day. As you went about your work, you walked past and here was another one dying. It was a representation of the fact that every sin we do caused the death of Christ and that he was willing to sacrifice everything for us, even in our sin. But he didn't intend that that would go on forever. The transformative power of God is where I'm going to end this sermon. It is really what the sanctuary message is about. This is from Ephesians 3:16-19. I'm going to do no more than read this to you. I want you to put it in your mouth and in your mind and roll it on your tongue and in your cerebrum. I want you to roll it around and think about this as your week goes by. It says that he would grant you, according to the riches of his glory, to be strengthened with might by his spirit in the inner man, that Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith, that ye, being rooted and grounded in love, may be able to comprehend with all saints what is the breadth, the length, the depth, and height, and to know the love of Christ, which passes knowledge, that ye might be filled with the fullness of God. Amen. May the Lord bless each of you. Thank you for turning pages for me. Bow your heads. May the Lord, the gracious Heavenly Father, be with all of us, each moment of our life. May He make us what He would want us to be. May He take our faith and make it whole and complete and forever. In Jesus' name, amen.
As Elder Arnie heads to the door, charge it to my head and not my heart, I forgot one very important announcement. March 26th, we have a passion play at Andrews University. We have 20 tickets. It's not a problem for us to get more tickets. If anyone is interested in going, we're going to speak about this also next Sabbath, the passion play at Andrews University. If anyone would like to go, anyone, just please let us know.